Well, I continue to do these videos because it's tremendous practice to give better and better voice to the good news, better and better expression. Wonderful. I really am pleased with the clarity that's coming through in being able to proclaim this little fly the good news. Little fly in my ear telling me something's spiritual buzz. There's a little buzz there. So maybe just a very little buzz that's going on here. Not much of a buzz yet. You see, not yet. We'll see what happens later. The previous video was, what was it? Something about the good news and boosting spiritual, helping us with spiritual demoralization, which is so strong in the world right now. So I really laid it on the line there. And then that was in the morning. And then the early evening, I find myself at Catholic Mass. I was like, oh, after what I just said. You know, I was looking around, you know, kind of, is anybody, you know, oh, wow, you know. It was, the juxtaposition was incredible, fantastic. Because you just don't hear, you know, if the gospel was being proclaimed, you know, I would want to listen to it. And maybe I'd spend my time doing that, but I don't hear it in the world the way I want to hear it. So I'm just saying, well, I'll do it then. I'll listen to what's coming out of my, you know, mouth. Because, you know, this is what I love to hear. This is what I love to hear. Because it's freeing us from tremendous delusion. And it can only lead to something truly glorious, even though it may seem difficult. But the contrast between my previous talk, my talk, and what was being said in church was quite a drastic contrast now. But nothing that really bothered me. I understood where it's coming from. But, wow. They need to correct the fundamental mistake and get the context, right. And that's quite a lot of work that's required to do that. So, just being able to share the good news, which is really quite extraordinary, is a blessing. You know, I'm kind of like, once I do the video, I'm like glowing almost. I'm just like, wow, this is great. You know, just that we can hear it in the world now. We can hear someone talk, you know, sharing it more than just reading in a book by ourselves. You know, this is more of an inclusive type of situation. We can hold ourselves up in a room and read the book and say, hey, is anybody know I'm reading this? You know, better hide the book away. Yeah, this is revolutionary. This is, you know, this turns everything right side up. And but by actually speaking it out loud and sharing it with the world through YouTube, anybody can watch. This is a way more intense, way more inclusive situation that's going on. It's way more difficult to do this than just read it in a book. But you know, we have to start somewhere of professing the faith. I think I believe Jesus told us that, you know, those who are given a lot and a lot is asked of them, and if you need to, you know, don't hide your light under a bushel. Profess the good news, share the good news. This is a responsibility that we have. But hearing it is a wow. That's the whole point. The whole point of it is to stop. Find the wow that stops you. Find the wow that's just a stop. Wow. This is, and then just let it be a super wow. The good news is a super wow. And one becomes sort of quiet, fairly quiet. A different mood arises. A different mood arises when we can decide to step into the super wow of the gospel, the great good news. All the thoughts and thinking that is sort of put on the back burner and sort of left behind, it's not so important anymore. What it really is we realize that the good news is true, and we accept it as true, but it's not just some sort of concept. It's not a concept anymore. We feel, you know, feel and know, this is true, this is true, this is true. What Jesus is telling us is true, and that's a big shift. That's a big shift. That's a big wow. That's a super wow. It's a super wow. Whole field of wow. I'm dwelling in a wow field, not just right here, but it has extension to it. So this is a step that's necessary before it can really be shared more publicly. Is that the wow, the super wow field needs to have extension to it, to absorb all the insanity in the world, actually. Sri Sri Anandamayi's wow, super wow field extended for several miles, actually. Several miles. Astonishingly potent. That's why she could absorb so much. Yeah. So, in order to really evangelize, there has to be an extension, which I call the super wow. The super wow. Step into the super wow. Super wowness. Full stop in super wowness. The wow is four-stage practice, where you feel it, the wow, just where you are, and you just feel wow. Super wow is where you feel that it's now spread out and permeating all around you, so subtly in some way. It's just, you're in this large field, so a large sphere of wowness. So this is a super wow, and you've accepted this is true, this is true. Truth is true. And nothing else is true. Truth is true and nothing else is true. People have been a little nicer to me. It seems like just a little nicer to me today. I had, you know, a few little chats with those I haven't had chats with, you know, maybe ever, or just see a little more sort of, I don't know, maybe the super wow field is starting to, you know, expand somehow. Maybe the willingness, you know, the capability, willingness to share this information is bringing about a super wow field. There's nothing that anybody should be frightened of, even those who might maybe oppose it mightily. No, later on they'll change their tune. Everyone will change their tune eventually. It's just a familiarity issue, is all it is. We've all been opposed stuff that we said, what is this? I don't like this. I know people who, anything new, no, I don't like that. No, don't like that. What do you mean? You've never even tried, you've never even looked at it. No, I don't like it. And then later on, maybe, wow, what is that? And gradually, hey, that's not so bad. And then later on, you know, it's okay. So it's just everyone's different that way. So it's true that this purpose of this planet is just to try and drive ourselves insane and disempower ourselves. That's what we're trying to do. You know, the fear of God and why we've been fooled ourselves, all this is accurate. Information is accurate. And, oh, we were in church today, I remember, the confession of sin, you know, and I confess that I have sinned, you know, and I said, you know, the only sin there is the belief that we can sin against God, against the will of God. That's the only sin there is. And since we can't, what consequences does that sin have? Nothing. And since it has no consequences, what meaning does it have? None. No meaning, no consequences, it's just nothing. Just forgive ourselves, as if it's silliness, and just set it down. But the notion that we can sin against the will of God, that is the sin. That is the sin. It's impossible to sin against the will of God. Because what is the will of God? Perfect freedom. Okay. And we can't help but be perfectly free. We are perfectly free. To play with any arising that we desire from pure potential, any instant at all. So all is available, always, for all. And there's no way that can be changed whatsoever. So it's impossible to sin against the will of God. Totally impossible. So believing we have sinned against the will of God, that's delusion. You know, that is the silly delusion. There's no atonement that needs to be made, really. You know, it's just to recognize, oh, we never did. We never did. It's impossible. We cannot. So, you know, it's just, wow. Just seeing the mistake, you know. It's so obvious. All of it. Sacrificial, you know, sacrifice to appease the bloodlust of God, you know. You know, that mistake. It's all the mistakes are there, just very clear. But I didn't feel in any way diminished. I don't feel diminished. It's not problematical. They're good people. They're hoping for salvation, looking for salvation, hoping that maybe they found it. And of course, problem is if you think maybe you found it, and then someone says, well, actually, it's this, then you say, whoa. I mean, maybe I didn't find it, and their reaction can be negative at first, like, oh, you're saying I haven't found it. And say, oh, God's going to kill me, you know, I'm afraid. I was supposed to... I believe that I was safe because I accepted the substitutionary sacrifice of Jesus Christ, meaning the substitutionary disempowerment for my own efforts at disempowerment. So God is no longer angry at me and wants to annihilate me. And then I'm hearing that isn't it? And I say, oh my God, you know me, you know. So it's a real tough one. It's a real tough one for people. Really tough. Because you feel too vulnerable. If you think you found a safe harbor from this dilemma, non-existent, ridiculous dilemma, actually ridiculous, and then you say, oh, this is not it. Whoops. People go away kind of scowling, you know. Can't believe you just said that. That's not right. Yeah. So it's tough, very tough. You have to start out with the premise that how could God possibly demand a substitutionary sacrifice to save us from his wrath, that somehow we deserve annihilation for sinning? We can't sin against God. Nothing real can be threatened. Nothing unreal exists. It's impossible that there be any threat to reality. So how could there be any anger? Why would there be a need of substitutionary sacrifice? You know, all this is because, of course, we're the ones who try to be greater than God, have a greater will than God. And by trying to disempower God and not being able to, we claim that, again, God created us to disempower God. And if we don't do it, then God will annihilate us. If we don't succeed at it. This is the conundrum that we're stuck in. And the Jesus situation, the way the world interpreted it was, it seemed like, oh, this is a nice little resolution to it. Instead of God annihilating us and disempower, instead of us failing to disempower ourselves, which we can't, God disempowered Jesus and said, oh, and God said, okay, you guys, that's good. Let's call it good. You succeeded at disempowering yourself, so I won't annihilate you. So the you know, it's a tricky little magical solution there, but you know, at further review, maybe it's like the baseball call, you know, at first base or home plate, a close call. I say we wouldn't go to review that one. And called, you know, something's out, and then they say dispute it. Let's go review. And they review. They look at all the different angles. And then slow it down, and they say, ah, upon further review, runner's safe. So we need to put this whole situation under review. That's all that I did. I put it under review. I said, now wait a minute, it's a close call, but it seems as though maybe the wrong call was made. Okay, what I said was, the traditional interpretation of Jesus' purpose coming here, I feel like, I said, maybe the wrong call was made. You know, I know there've been a lot of so-called brilliant minds throughout history working on this, trying to make it fit, you know. You got St. Thomas Aquinas, you know, writing Summa Theologica and twisting and turning it. He's like, I sort of got it, you know. I said, but not quite, I don't quite have it. And everyone said, well, it was a great effort, did a great effort. It's good enough, good enough for us, you know. I said, whoa, wait a minute. Let's review this, all of this. Again, let's put it under review. Let's look at it from different angles, you know. Slow it down. So I slowed it all down. Went real slow. Patient, really slow. Just like one little thing at a time. This, just, I said, this isn't quite right. So but upon doing that, gradually you start to see, you know, the play and what really, you know, what really, how the play really is. Of course, the way they interpret it is that when you die, that's when everything's fine. Not here, but when you die, everything, it all works out there. And I said, oh, wait a minute, I remember dying my previous lives, and it didn't all work out there, actually. I said, let's take that off the books. That's not, dying doesn't do it for you. And they say, well, if you just have the right faith, well, even that doesn't work out. Something's fishy, something that's not adding up, actually. So I was able to work simultaneously on the overall context and also specific details, and shift back and forth and just, you know, somehow keep it all going. And gradually a different picture emerged. And fortunately I had Jesus' own explanation for what the truth is. And so I could, you know, listen to that and then compare it, you know, to what we have believed here for thousands of years. And I said, oh, wait a minute. You know, what's true here? What's true? Let's find out what's true. Let's just find out what is true. It's very important. You know, let's get it here now, not after we die, where we can't really, don't know exactly what happened. Most of us still here. That seems like somewhat of a questionable approach. And so I said, what is the Occam's razor? What is the most simplest, most obvious explanation for this? And what Jesus said, I said, hey, this sounds like the simplest, best explanation, and it fits. So let's pursue this. Let's pursue it. So instead of just refuting, what I did was said, let's first take the most obvious explanation, and let's just see if that's wrong. Okay, so that's a much smarter way to go about it, right? Because you can spend forever refuting false premises and, you know, the swamp of delusion. Goes on forever, but it's better to take what you feel and believe and see is most likely the right explanation, as simple as really tend to think this is probably it, and then look at that carefully. Because if it is it, then you saved yourself, you know, just an incredible amount of time, as well as keeping yourself, you know, motivated. Because so I put faith in what Jesus had to say, and I said, I believe this is most likely true. So let me just keep focusing on this and seeing, you know, how it all fits together, and if it all holds together, and if it's cohesive, and if it just really brings additional clarity. And so that's what I did. And try not to be comparative too much. Again, see, that's a slow way too, and that causes a lot of conflict. The smart way, find what you believe is the right theory, the most obvious, the most simple, with the most elegant, that just fits really well, and then really see if, test that one out, and test it out. So I put it to the test, and it's testing out well. It's like flying a jet pilot, test pilot, out this prototype, you know, and it holds up great, flies great. The engineers tell us, hey, this plane's gonna fly great, but we'd like you to test it. It's okay, let's test it out. Oh yeah, it's wonderful. So spiritual test pilot, entertaining ideas, entertain these ideas. Jesus keeps dropping these ideas in for us. Here you go. What about this idea? You say, well, let's entertain this idea. See what kind of guest it is. Some of these ideas are so amazing that they come into your house and you just kind of like sit there like, wow, look who's come, you know, visiting, look who's come for supper, wow. It's like that. I mean, imagine if someone real VIP came to your house and like, can I come in for a bite to eat? And you say, come on in. It's like, oh, wow. Tend to be real, a little bit shy, reticent, right? It's like, well, yeah, that's what it's like. Because these ideas are just game changers, total game changers. And it's an honor just to host, you know, entertain these ideas. It just feel like how astonishing. So, just practice being humble, unassuming, humble, modest, repentant, and just hang out with these ideas and you know, just be quiet. Back in the day, we had the idea of, you know, celebrity, someone really important. These days, maybe with all the way the world is now, we don't feel so much in awe of the real bigwigs. You know, I can't think of anyone. If they came to my, you know, came to the house and, you know, can you come on in? I can't think of anyone that'd feel like, you know, overawed or anything like that. But in the day, back in the day, I think it's like that. So just imagine, like, you're just being very polite and calm and not saying much, you know, just quiet. And get used to the fact that they're there. The idea is there. Keep in mind that God created us as spirit and truth. We're an idea in the mind of God. So when we're entertaining these ideas, we're entertaining the thoughts that we think with God. Jesus is not actually some human person. Jesus says he's actually this glowing, shimmering sphere of light, and he doesn't see himself as a body at all. Doesn't see us as bodies either, and works with ideas and essence, and so these ideas are really what we are, largely what we are. Certainly, at least emissaries of what we are. So to host these ideas is very potent, and it needs to be recognized as such. It's a very sacred, potent situation to be taken quite seriously at a full stop. The practicing of this is super helpful, super helpful, super, super helpful. Even though it may seem like a strain, and oh my gosh, you know, this something where a VIP is visiting me right now. Wow. Well, for example, like the Dalai Lama. Let's say Dalai Lama came to your home and they said, "Can I have a cup of tea? Let's sit down and have a cup of tea together." He's like, it's like, well, yeah. For some people, that would be like a big deal, you know? I've told the story when I was got close to the Dalai Lama, and he just let out this huge peals of laughter towards me. He just looked at me, just laughing, laughing, laughing. And maybe he was saying, hey, that's when you realize the absurdity of this world. You just laugh. You just laugh. The absurdity, the premise that if we don't disempower God, then God's going to annihilate us. You know how absurd it is, and all we need to do is actually just laugh. Remember to laugh. So maybe that the grace was working through the Dalai Lama, just telling me, hey, remember to laugh. That's it. He didn't say anything to me. I thought he might say something or talk with me. Do you have a question? You know, I was so close. I thought he said, do you have a question? Or no, he just looked and started laughing and laughing and laughing and laughing. That's it. So that was some sort of transmission, you know, through the Dalai Lama to me, saying, remember to laugh, remember to laugh. Stay light, lighten up so you can laugh about it. Lighten up so you can laugh. Very important. So that was something very profound. I was a little surprised by it, actually. So yeah, if someone like that's really, you know, quite VIP-ish, you're with them. Just imagine how you would be if you're with some super VIP like the Dalai Lama, for example. and try to be that way with these ideas, with those ideas, with the gospel, with the good news. Have that attitude and practice that. Practice, 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 practice that attitude. That's why I say we need someone like Sri Sri Anandamayi in the world, so we can practice that attitude. Someone has a super wow field that is just so intense, and you just realize, wow. Let me just shut up. Let me just sit here and be quiet and get used to this. That is super helpful. Someone that just knocks us out and just go silent. Yeah, this is what we need. This is what the world needs. And if we start thinking, we just say, forget it. I forget it. No, forget it. Not now. Forget it. You know, like if you're with the Dalai Lama, you're not going to start saying, hey, Dalai Lama, how are you, man? How was your travels? You know, you encountered any weather? You know, how are you feeling here in the States? You feeling some jet lag or something? And, you know, how's your health? You feeling okay? Blah, chat, 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 chat. Now you're just going to just go quiet, be quiet. And expect, you know, expect miracles, expect use the opportunity to practice profundity, practice being in the presence of the profound, being in the presence of the profound. Use the opportunity, use the opportunity. Use it as an excuse if you want to, if you want to look at it that way. Here's the opportunity, you know, let me practice being with the profound, because truth is completely profound. It's totally self-evidently profound. So now, the smart ones do that. They're the quiet ones. They're the ones who maybe just they're practicing the dead. You know, and the convivial ones, blah blah, blah, they're missing it. You know, they're missing it. Now maybe there be some teachers, you know, a lot of teachers in the world that maybe they're not all that, but it can be used as a good excuse for us to practice. Practice going into this full stop in the now of wow. Because maybe you're feeling, well, there's a little wow field here, and I'm just feeling this, so let me practice that. Let me just practice it. Just be quiet and still in it. The more we do that, the better able we are to entertain the really profound ideas that come with the gospel, the good news that Jesus is really bringing, that is just knockout. That's just, it's just wow. Super potent. So the better able we are to entertain that. And then when we do, when we entertain some of these ideas, we know and just say, wow, I'm entertaining this idea, this is fantastic. But we're used to staying still and quiet, humble, meek, unassuming. And we realize we have a severe continuity fear, so we'll cloud it over, we'll react to it, our mind will want to start jumping around reacting to it, so we try to keep the mind still. Don't get carried away by any concatenation, any storyline, theme, scenario, musing, planning. So even if you sit at church and practice being still, that's helpful. It doesn't even matter what's being said so much. It's the fact that you're practicing. You're practicing feeling, you know, the presence of the profound. Even if it's not clearly delineated. Even if it's mistakenly delineated, like for instance, the way that Jesus had interpreted, still, a mistaken interpretation of Jesus, why he came here, is still profound. Right? That's still profundity there. Absolutely there is. Because, like, we're trying. The event, you know, the situation has happened, and we're responding to it, even though we're a little bit off. Still, that is profound. It's like a great pitcher throwing batting practice and throws one, and he throws a great fastball and you miss it. Swing and miss. You say, wow, I missed it. Still pretty awesome to be up there, you know, at the plate batting against this pitcher. You know, this is great. So maybe next time you'll hit it. Just the very fact that people are talking about Jesus is profound, even though they may be projecting their damned if you do, don't, damned if you don't fear of God scenario upon the whole situation. Still, there's profundity in it. The very fact that we're contemplating is profound, even without an idea. Even without an idea. As we're told, just the effort itself is the grace of God. The very fact that we're making an effort is extremely profound. That's why, even though maybe a breakthrough is not happening for you, stay in the mood of repentance, because it's what you're doing is profound. You are trying to make yourself available for a breakthrough. That too is very profound. So continue to take it seriously and full stop in the now of the whatever wow is happening. Now, when you have a super wow feel, even those at a distance who are walking in that field, never come close to maybe the one who's emanating this field. They see, feel something profound is going on. This was reported in the journals of those, some of us coming to visit Sri Sri Anandamayi, and somehow. It was someone who I think didn't know about her or something like that, and was walking, and met a friend, and the friend said, "Oh, you want to come see someone? Some great saint is here or something." And they're talking about how they felt something profoundly different. They felt everything was like still, even the insects and animals and people. Everyone seemed like calm, peaceful, still. Whereas just where it was before, just, you know, it wasn't that way. And it seems like he felt like, wow, what's happened? And then eventually meeting and getting in tune to this whole situation, you know, he realized that this was this incredible effect at a distance. So you don't, you know, we can be affected by the super wow fields at a distance like that, actually. there's a feeling of peace that descends upon the area, the whole area. And everyone feels sort of, you know, meditative. Their thoughts turn, their attention turns toward inward automatically. So as much as possible, rehearse, 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 rehearse. Whatever you can find that quiets your mind, where you feel like you're not reacting. Just full stop. As long as we're reacting, we haven't gone far enough. Okay, haven't gone far enough in our contemplation and meditation. So find whatever one can find where it brings that full stop feeling like, nothing needs to be said here. This is beyond words. I don't need to say anything about it. This is profound beyond words. It doesn't need words to augment it. Practice that, practice it, practice it, practice it. So keep looking for that which triggers the wow. And the more you do the wow, the closer you get to stepping into the super wow, as I call it. Where it seems non-localized, the non-localized super wow. As I go about the world, moving around today, you just notice the people, just like so many people are, they look collapsed, they look dispirited. Now, of course, young people always seem to be dispirited. Not always. Actually, if you go to late night grocery stores or something, people can look very dispirited. Young people, you know, but oftentimes we mistake just the vitality of youth for some sort of, you know, very sane state of not, but no, that's just covering it up, just a temporary vigor and vitality of youth, because later on you see them in their lives and, wow, we saw a man in church today that was, he acted very peculiar. Someone used to come all the time, but he didn't even sit down. He went in an odd place and sat down. He was completely out of sync with the whole thing. Everyone was kind of looking at him like, wow, what happened to him? You know, he was experiencing some sort of collapse or some sort. Just look at the people, you can see that their efforts to disempower themselves, at least symbolically, are showing up as the body. Body's just a symbol. Oh, this is just symbolic. But the symbology is very strong, saying, look what I'm able to do here. Look at that. Look at this. Look at the disempowerment. I'm succeeding. They're saying, I'm winning, I'm winning, I'm so disempowered, I'm winning. So in order to step into the super wow, you have to give up the whole notion of disempowerment. Otherwise, we'll stay contracted. We can experience the localized wow, which eventually we should finally kind of release the contractedness of the idea of disempowerment and begin to be aware that our so-called body extends, you know, in all directions for quite a bit, and it's not so localized as we thought. But in order to do that, we have to give up the symbology of disempowerment. To become radiant, we have to give up the symbology of disempowerment, for sure. We won't seem disempowered anymore. So a lot of people look at us and they'll look at you and say, what a loser. Yeah, what a loser. What happened to them? You know, what happened to them? They're not going to earn a place in heaven that way. So, I think that this shift from the wow to the super wow is where it's at right now. Somehow this is very helpful for others, very helpful if you have this field of super wow, where you just realize it's really beyond words. It's like, I remember you used to play baseball on sand lots and parks and schools and whatever grassy area you can find or whatever, and just walking into like a big league, major league baseball park, you go through the entrance and go through these, you know, to where the seats are, you know, and you come out and then you just see the green, you know, how it's set up, and you just go, wow. And you don't need to say anything, you just, huh. This is big time. Yeah. Anyone who starts trying to analyze it, well, let me see now, you know, and think, no, that's stupid. You know, it's big, you know, this is big time. This is big time. This is big time. So the super wow, you know, this is big time. That's it. And so much stuff goes out the window then. Just forget it. All these thoughts, then you say, that's stupid. Forget it. Forget it. Not gonna entertain any of that stuff. This is big time. I'm gonna sit down and watch this game. This is going to be fun. You know, you see, watching this game is going to be a blast. This is great. Look at the lights, the grass, the everything is just so wow. Grass is emerald green and lush and beautiful, and just everything. The smells, it's just the whole thing. Wow. This is a big time. The buzz, you know, the buzz and everything. Oh, just sit down. Just sit down. Just take it in. It's nothing to act cavalier about, you know. Nothing to be cavalier about. See, just throw it out the window. The cavalierness, the nonchalantness, just throw it out the window. See, forget it. I'm going to get into this. This is a This is a buzz. I'm going to get into this. I'm going to just feel this. Wow. Forget the person, forget the teacher, forget everything. Just the field. I mean, if this is something's profound, forget, just say, wow, I'm just going to, something's, you know, really profound. I'm just going to get used to that. I don't care about trying to explain so much. It's here, I feel it. Just, I'm gonna get used to it. That's it. So this is the wise move, the wise strategy. It's very good again for spiritual morale. It's very good. Very, very, very helpful. It's the antidote. It's the antidote. So, the wow into the super wow. Maybe that's the next step. We'll soon find out. All right, that's it for this one.